What's going on, everybody?
What's going on? What's happening? Martin? How you doing, man?
Pretty good, man. It's sesh night. Feels like it's been a month. It's only been a week we've been off.
I know. We took a week off, and you know what? My whole week was a little bit off kilter. I would just add.
No sesh?
Yeah, no sesh. I didn't have that, you know. I did listen to music that night, so that was nice. But without you and without the dear listeners. But it's all good. What's happening, everybody?
Yeah, good to see you folks. Thanks so much for joining us. I'm really stoked to listen to what we're listening to. And I'm stoked to listen to it with who we're listening to it with. We have a very special guest tonight. It's our dear friend and brilliant pianist, open studio artist, the great Geoffrey Keezer is here. Hey, Geoffrey.
Hey. What's up, man? Whoa, there I am. What's going on, guys? How's everybody in St. Louis? How's the scene like down there?
It is probably similar to what it is there. A lot of indoor home activity, and it's creeping back. Adam has some exciting news because he actually had said you have a gig this week, right?
I have a gig,
an IRL gig.
I have a in real life gig at
IRL
at a 1,000-seat venue where they're letting in 50 people.
That's it. Sounds like one of my stadium gigs, one of my arena concerts. Yeah, yeah.
But I'm excited just to even play for those 50 people is going to be very thrilling, I think, and maybe even emotional. We'll see how it goes. But
I'm excited
to get to it.
I'm going to call you at the last minute to see if I can get on the guest list just to let you know, Adam. Oh, that's cool.
Yeah.
That's
Timmy,
one out of 50.
Yeah, yeah. Well, I mean, of course, the joke for us, you know, being, you know, when they talk about, like in New York, they were for a while talking about opening at 30% capacity and then 50, and then they go through this thing where for a while you couldn't ticket events and you couldn't advertise that you're actually having music, you know, and it's just been, you know, the news changes every day, but you know, the idea of playing to a room that's at like 30% capacity is not completely foreign to us.
I know.
That just sounds like a Tuesday, you know?
That's a late set.
That's yeah.
They don't realize we can go lower than that.
Much lower than that.
Don't put a floor at 30. We can
That's right. Yeah. So, you know.
So have you done anything in person recently?
Mm-mm. No live gigs yet. Supposedly something we're doing something in July up here in Tarrytown. Something that's been, you know, it was like scheduled last March or April and it was rescheduled and rescheduled again, and this is like the fourth iteration I think of the date for the gig, you know.
Right
I'm hoping it'll happen, you know.
Yeah, well, I mean, part of the problem I'm having at this point is I'm getting some of those gigs that have been rescheduled twice and now they're like no, it's really, but it's like you start after something's been rescheduled two times, you don't even use pencil anymore. It just never makes it into the calendar. So I feel like I'm gonna just totally miss showing up at that point. They're like, come on, we had a gig. You know,
what's like before crayon or something?
Right, that's right. Invisible ink.
Invisible ink. That's
really
invisible
ink. Weird. Yeah. For this gig coming up tomorrow night, I had a rehearsal. That was weird. That's a whole other gear.
Wow. Oh, that's worse than the gig, man.
It was very awkward.
That's more dangerous than the gig.
Yeah. How did that go?
It went well. I mean, it was just great to play with other human beings, but it was, you get on this pattern your whole career of like, here's a rehearsal, here's a gig, here's a rehearsal, here's a gig,
right?
And then I've just been playing here in my house. a rehearsal to actually rehearse for, it's just a gear I haven't used in a year. It's interesting.
Yeah it's gonna be interesting, but hey, you know, we'll get there.
That's right
Well, we've spent this pandemic listening to some great albums and tonight's no exception, and Geoffrey, we're so thrilled to have you with us. And
thank you,
this was your pick tonight's album.
Yes, it was
Phineas Newborn Jr., A World of Piano. I mean, this is a heavy hitter.
this album, okay, so I met a pianist named James Williams when I was like 16, 17, like in, you know, mid late 80s at a jazz convention. It was the NAJE at the time, which became the IAJE, which became Gen now. But you know, and I recognized him because I had one of his albums that I bought at the mall. You know, I said, James Williams, wow, cool, can I get a lesson? He goes, yeah, sure. And we found a piano room, I mean a room with a piano in it, like literally a ballroom, an unused ballroom in the basement somewhere that had an old upright, and at like 1 o'clock in the morning. So he gave me a piano lesson. And he said, yeah, play something, you know, play something. He goes, okay, have you ever heard of Phineas Newborn? And he said Phineas, even though people from Memphis said Phineas, you know, colloquially it was Phineas Newborn. But he said, have you ever heard of Phineas Newborn? I said, no. And I'd already been, you know, listening to a lot of stuff, listening to Monk and Bud and, you know, even like, you know, modern guys like Mulgrew and Kenny Kirkland and stuff. But Phineas and Oscar Peterson, of course, I had no idea who Phineas Newborn was. So he said, man, listen, you got to get a record called A World of Piano. I said, okay. And so, you know, when I got home, I ordered it maybe from Jamie Ebersole. Remember the mail order catalog?
Yeah, sure. That's you right. Know? Yep.
We're dating ourselves, but I don't care.
LP or cassette? LP or cassette?
Cassette, right? I got it on LP and I put this record down and I went, you know, holy crap. And it really gave me a direction to go with my piano playing. Mm-hmm. I want to play like this guy. And if I do anything different, I just want to maybe, you know, update it, quote unquote, update it harmonically or something. But I mean, it this is how I want to play piano. Phineas sounded to me like he had four hands, you know, operating at all times. And, you know, not just the chops, which were phenomenal, but the musicality, the orchestration aspect of everything he does, you know, the blues, everything, you know, the blues is always a big part of it, you know, and it's just like, I mean, as you will hear tonight, you know, like, for example, the tune Manteca, you know, he plays the entire Dizzy Gillespie big band arrangement on the piano. If you know the original, you
there's a lot going on.
You compare them side by side. He hits everything. He hits the bass lines, the trombones, he hits the saxophone lines, he hits the trumpets, like everything is there, you know. But you know, we'll go track by track and talk about it. But he's still one of my this is still one of my Desert Island records. He's one of my biggest piano heroes. I never got to meet him, you know. He passed away in like 87 ish, you know, and it was like I was just starting to, I maybe if he had lived another couple of years, I might have had a chance to meet him, but I didn't. But boy, sure heard a lot of stories about him from Harold Mayburn, you know, and James and Mulgrew and Charles Thomas and those cats, man. I mean, Phineas was the godfather of that, you know, that whole generation of piano players.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Absolutely. Yeah. Well, why don't we jump in hear track one? And is there anything you want to do to set this up? I mean, you just set it up great, the whole album. But we're always talking on here just about, you know, how these classic records, how the, you know, different concepts on how to set the table with the first track. But what's your feeling on this one?
Yeah, well, the thing about this record, okay, so it's eight tracks, and, you know, side A of the vinyl, and they were both recorded with rhythm sections from working bands. So side A, the first four tunes are with Philly Joe Jones and Paul Chambers, who were Miles Davis's rhythm section. This is recorded in 1961. Side B is with Sam Jones and Lewis Hayes, who were playing with Cannonball. So they were both like, and this album was recorded a month apart, like October and November of 1961. Both sessions were in Los Angeles. And so I'm assuming maybe those bands were in town, you know, at those times working someplace.
Yeah.
And they just went to the studio and they cut these records. And it's like, you know, it's just super, super killing. The first tune is Cheryl, Charlie Parker Blues in C. And actually, so I use this to teach block chords. In fact, one of my lessons on Open Studio is called Phineas Newborn Jr.'s Cheryl, a study in block chords. Because if you listen to his solo, which is like stunning, like it's just absolutely a masterclass in so many things. But chorus four and five of this solo, he demonstrates pretty much every conceivable way that you can do block chord runs on the piano. You know, they're in first and parallel fourths, then they're in like literally like diatonic, like parallel moving up, you know, up the keyboard at like a blazing speed. Some of it's like you just hear all these different variations, and if you get my lesson, you know, I kind of break it down for you. But yeah, This is just super killing. I mean, even the way he starts his solo out with the triplets, ascending triplets up the piano, the chromatic thing, and then playing a solo with his left hand underneath all that. You know,
yep.
It's stupid.
So I just put a link here to that course with that lesson. It's from Keys to Jazz Piano, And for everybody watching, I'm going to make that lesson, the free sample lesson, tonight and for the next couple of days. Okay. So if you want to check out what Geoffrey Keezer is talking about with literally what we're about to listen to here with Cheryl, check it out. This is Phineas Newborn Jr., recorded in 1961 with Philly Joe Jones and Paul Chambers. Doesn't get much better than this. Enjoy, everybody.
Yeah.
There it is. Man. There it is.
You know,
holy smokes. Those block chords, though. What's going on there?
You know, yeah, all kinds of stuff. I mean, the other thing is like the swing factor. Like just that his time is just so good. It's just locked in. You know, there's no, you know, sometimes piano players will do a lot of pyrotechnics and a lot of really cool stuff or play really cool voicings, but sometimes the groove gets compromised. Mm. You know, sometimes you feel like it has to be one or the other. Like, you know, if you play with a groove, you can't play too complicated, you know, but it's like, all those ideas are there and they're in the pocket, you know?
Yeah. Mm. I was wondering, so I had forgotten about this. I hadn't listened to this record in a while, but I can almost remember the first time I heard it. And I think one thing that and this record affected me so much. But what was different, probably with you, Keezer, and almost every other pianist, like we all heard this, especially if we heard it like as teenagers, and we're like, oh my God, I could never do that, or maybe later. You must have heard it and like, oh my God, I'm going to learn all that, you know?
Well, and it really became, I wanted to try, but yeah.
But it resonated with you on that level. But I forgot, like, the he's playing the head in, and he's swinging so hard that he's actually playing it kind of straight and able to get away with that, you know? And then on the way out, it's like the first melody, he's swinging it, and then he goes back to that kind of straight feel. And it somehow worked. Like, it doesn't throw off PC and Philly Joe. You can tell it's not like they rehearsed and planned that. But like they just sort of adjust right there, and it's a really cool sort of different way of playing it. And I always thought it was almost like, man, he's swinging so hard, he can just start playing straight, and it's still swinging.
Well, it's still swinging because I mean that's that whole like as long as you know as long as the accents are in the right place, it still swings. You know, the phrasing and the accents is not just like the amount of triplet versus you know it's like the dial. Right. You remember the old Lindrum?
Machine,
you know, right. You could dial in the amount of swing you wanted.
That's right.
You
know, right.
Human, I know some drummers call like it human feel.
Yeah, human, exactly.
Human feel.
Non-quantized. And then the way, you know, that great triplet build up, which is, and for anybody else, would be such an odd place to start the solo there. Mm-hmm. You know, it's so brilliant. And I was thinking, like, that is a nice, you know, talking about the first tune on an album, it's almost like the curtain is open. Like he plays the head, and then they go in and they're swinging. He's like, D-d-d-d-d-d. It's almost like the album is being introduced, the curtain, and the trio's there, you know?
Yeah.
It's such a cool thing structurally, I think, the way it's laid out. And then, you know, of course, he just goes to town, as we say.
Yeah, I mean, I would love to hear some outtakes from this record. I don't know if you've ever, but apparently Joe Zawinul said, because he was at the session for the other side of the record because he was playing with Cannonball Adderley in 1961. And so I guess he attended the session, and he said there were some outtakes from that record that are like even crazier than the takes that, you know, the ones that made the record. And he said, Phineas came out of the booth. I don't know what tune it was, but he came out of the booth. He said, no, we can't use that one. I played too much piano on that.
Whoa. he's like, that was the universe of piano. That wasn't just the world of piano.
You know, multiverse. Yeah. I played too much piano. We can't use that one.
Oh, that's funny.
You can hear the influence too, Geoffrey, listening to so much of your music over the years. I mean, I can hear your the young Geoffrey. I can hear what you were going for when you said, you know, if I could just sound like this, but updated. I think you've achieved that and more. But
I copped a lot of his, you know, at least the ideas of trying to, you know, the two-handed runs. And I mean, Phineas, that's not exclusive to Phineas Newborn. I mean, Oscar Peterson does that as well. You can hear a lot of Errol Garner and Phineas is playing. Yeah. I mean, it's the whole tradition and the whole history is there, obviously. But Phineas just took it and he just put everything together in a different way, you know?
Yeah, and I think even on this track, and of course, we're going to hear it throughout the album, he did such a great job of connecting that performance and that solo, even though it's kind of encyclopedic in a way. Like when he goes into that, there's that one of the block chords choruses where it's just like straight, it's like Oscar Peterson, like you can see Oscar Peterson, but it doesn't feel disconnected from what he had just played. And he's almost going chorus by chorus at times, which is sort of a faux pas, you know, as we know. It's like, no, play a whole solo. But I mean, just the feel, and I think the concept and the architecture of it is so much there that it enables him to do that, and it's really thrilling.
Oh yeah, that's quite a ride, man.
Yeah,
that track.
Well, let's check out the a true world of piano here with the next Phineas Newborn Jr.'s a piano arrangement of the big band arrangement of Manteca.
Yeah, and this is truly like a piano reduction of the big band chart. It's amazing. It's crazy.
Here we go.
Thank you.
crazy. It's insane.
I love the way Philly Joe played that off, that he didn't know he was going to that last chord. That's so, I love that. It's like, don't try to fix it, just bang, just slide into it.
That's right. That's
I was going to say, one of my favorite parts of here, I always love hearing Philly Joe and PC outside of Miles's band. There's something, there's a looseness, like they're just like, you know, we're on holiday for a second, so we're just going to have a good time.
They're like, we might not be getting paid as much.
Yeah, exactly.
We're not getting vibed as much.
Yeah, exactly. You can tell there's a bit of freedom with that. They're having fun.
That's funny. Yeah, maybe.
But anyway, man, I second your notion, Geoffrey, that aside from, you know, the obvious technical pyrotechnics that are possible here, the swing is what's drawing you in and keeping you there. You know, it's his sense of feel is so amazing. And his sound, his touch on the piano, I think it's probably lighter than you might think it is. Just listening to some of those lines just now, like it feels very... yeah, it's not super heavy, right? Like a power without it being too heavy. So volume and a big sound, but it feels kind of like he might have a bit of a light touch.
I don't know. I mean, because these are early recordings too, and if you listen to some of his later stuff, he might be hitting the piano a little harder on the later stuff. It kind of gets a view. And sometimes the time gets really kind of heavy and it starts to drag a little bit. But like, I mean, these records, like, you know, from like the early 60s up through like, when did he do Harlem Blues and Please Send Me Someone to Love? Is it like 69, 68, 69? I think, I could be wrong. I'm terrible with dates and stuff, but
yeah,
those records with Ray Brown and Elvin Jones are super killing.
Oh, also, yeah.
1969.
Yeah. Harlem Blues is great. I mean, and then Ray Brown kind of, you know, kept, you know, Phineas was kind of, you know, in and out of having, you know, he had some, you know, health problems and stuff and maybe mental health issues, you know, And I know that he didn't play like and record consistently, you know, throughout his whole life. And Ray would kind of try to pull him back in every now and then. Like in the mid 70s, they made a record with the drummer named Jimmy Smith, who lives in Japan. But, you know, nice, you know, pocket, you know, down the middle, hard swinger kind of drummer. And then James Williams kind of rebooted his career in the 80s, you know. Got Phineas out there recording again and touring a little bit, and you know, some of the stuff is good, but this is like the real stuff, you know.
Yeah, yeah.
His records are just so happening. So Lush Life, so his intro to Lush Life, he uses Ravel, the Ravel Sonatine in D flat as an intro, which is like, you know, it's beautiful. It doesn't exactly correlate harmonically. I don't think it's used because like it has the same chord changes as Lush Life or anything like that, but it's just maybe, you know, Lush Life, if you think of it, it's kind of having like an impressionistic vibe harmonically, yeah. Something, you know, it works well, I think, you know.
Yeah, for sure. So is that what we have up next?
Yeah, that's Lush Life is the third next. Track. Yeah. Nice.
Okay.
Let's check it out. Thank you. That's Lush Life from Phineas Newborn Jr.'s A World of Piano. Oh, hold on. Phineas, wait for us. That's 1962's A World of Piano with Philly Joe Jones, Paul Chambers. That's beautiful. And Geoffrey, Alec here commented something that I think is really relevant. All these layers on dynamics along with the melody, brilliant. And I remember you teaching a lesson talking about sort of these levels of dynamics within, you know, sort of the counter melodies and the mist in the air. I remember you talking about, you know, things above and below where the melody is. And you could really hear that there.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, they're full orchestrations. You could, you know, if you wrote that out and assigned some of the higher parts to woodwinds and some of the lower mm-hmm. parts to some other, you know, cellos or whatever you want. I mean, you've got basically full orchestration. So it's very well, but I think it was spontaneous. It doesn't sound like it was all mapped out ahead of time. You know, maybe some of it was, you know, some parts of it may have been, but again, we don't have enough recordings of him doing the same songs. Like you can listen to Art Tatum and go, okay, Art Tatum kind of definitely had this arrangement that he played, right? You know, cause you can listen to it in the 30s and the 40s and the 50s. It's like basically the same thing. Doesn't take away from the greatness or brilliance of it, but like that was his thing that he worked out. But we don't really have enough, you know, different versions of Phineas playing tunes that we really can tell, you know. But I mean, you take a tune of his like Sugar Ray, an original composition of Phineas Newborn's, and he recorded that at least twice, you know, once with Paul Chambers and Roy Haynes on the record We Three. Mm-hmm. But there's another recording of it with his brother Calvin on guitar. It's a quartet. His brother Calvin, by the way, gave Elvis guitar lessons. Oh, and the other thing about Phineas Newborn is apparently he could play many, many instruments very well. Like he played piano, of course, but he also played great tenor sax. He could play bass, drums, vibes, you know, trumpet, like wow. Just one of those, like, you know, super cats. Yeah.
Yeah.
Wow. Yeah.
Well, something you just mentioned, it made me think of just about the orchestral nature of Phineas's playing, which is something that we use with a lot of great pianists. Like you say, you know, they really can play it like an orchestra. But I always think that, like, you really know that's happening, like in his case, when, you know, as you say, you can imagine the different registers he goes through, the different kind of parts, you know. Oh, wow, that's woodwinds. That's like, it almost would arrange itself. Like, if you wanted to orchestrate this, you don't have to be a master orchestrator. You just have to have ears. And he kind of leads you there. And I think mm-hmm. that's it's such a beautiful thing, really, about the instrument of the piano. No matter what style you're playing, when it's in the hands of a master like this, it's evocative of an orchestra. If you want to go onto the different layers, it's its own thing too, you know, but it has those layers there. And I almost think that that's not necessarily even a jazz thing or a Lush Life or Billy Strayhorn. That's just a mastery of the instrument and technically what it can do. And not even just the velocity stuff, just like how you can play the different registers, play with a different kind of touch and pull that out of it. And it's very exciting. Very exciting.
Yeah. Yeah. And, you know, there's the execution, I mean, but there's the ideas too. It's just like the actual, like, to have those orchestration and arranging ideas and have them just flow out of you like that, you know?
Yeah.
You know what I mean? It's like,
yeah. And I'm glad you said execution too, because he's not lacking for very high level execution on this whole album, but yeah. He's going for stuff, but you can just feel the confidence. This was not like, oh, let me go back and overdub my part because I screwed up when I went up to the upper register. That was not the vibe on this. It was like,
right.
When he was moving up there, he knew where he was going, and he knew he was at a 99% chance of proper execution, pretty much.
For sure. Let's keep it going. Yeah. Daoud is next.
Daoud.
It's a hard word to read.
it's an Arabic word, and I can't remember. It means something nice, but I can't remember what it means. But it's yeah.
This is the last track with. This is the
last. We'll Google it.
Yeah. This is the last track with Philly Joe and PC. Yeah.
And so we got to go to the B rhythm section on the B side. You know, we're gonna talk about that though.
Yeah, B team. Yeah.
Yeah. Big downgrade.
This is Daoud. Thank you. Daoud. Phineas Newborn Jr. swinging.
Zach is, we have some.
That's very funny. Yeah.
We have some very witty, funny regulars around here. None more so than Zach from down in the great state of Texas.
He does have his video stuff comes together. he's getting it. He's getting it. You know, it just needs to transcribe Phineas some more.
Well, we often talk about how, you know, we always feel like, you know, Herbie's the ultimate, like, because, I mean, who have we ever said more of, like, he's got his Herbie stuff together, you know? So
yeah,
that's like, Chick or Herbie, like, you know, and then sometimes they had each other's, you know, Chick would have his Herbie stuff, Herbie would have his Chick, but no one ever had their Herbie stuff better than Herbie, and nobody has their Phineas stuff. You would be number two, though, Keys.
Oh, sure. Come on. No, there's a lot of pianists out here. You know, some that come to mind, in fact, are Bill Charlap. He really knows. He knows his Phineas backwards and forwards. So does Mike Ledon. Young guys like Sullivan Fortner and Dan Nimmer, the cat with Lincoln Center. Man, his block chords are redonkulous. Yeah. Like, he can play that stuff. You know,
he does that thing, right, where he puts his fingers in almost like a fist, like his thumb, his pinky are playing octaves, and he's just like kind of playing. It's amazing.
He's like freakish stuff, but but I mean, Phineas definitely inspired a ton of people, and you know, I mean, Oscar Peterson loved him. Oscar would talk about him. He was kind of, I don't know, because I never talked to Oscar Peterson about Phineas specifically, but, you know, James Williams was like, you know, Phineas is like the only dude that Oscar will like fully unequivocally give it up to all the time. You know, Amma Jamal loved Phineas Newborn, you know, and not just, you know, not just other piano players, but, you know, I mean, Katz would talk about him, you know, horn players, and Phineas very rarely recorded as a sideman. But there's one album, at least, well, there's a couple that he's on, but there's one in particular. It's Teddy Edwards and Howard McGhee. And the rhythm section is Phineas Newborn, Ray Brown, and Ed Thigpen. So again, it's Oscar Peterson's working rhythm section with Phineas on piano. And that record is killing. And the intro, there's a tune of Ray's on there called Up There that we used to play with Ray, but they recorded it like really fast. And Phineas plays this intro that's like this fully contrapuntal. It starts in unison, and then hand, like, you know, contrary motion stuff, you know, and hands it again, an improvised, you know, off the cuff intro. That's just like, he could have just, you know, done a dozen of those before he rolled out of bed in the morning. You know, I mean, it's just brilliant.
Great stuff.
Yeah, man.
So as we're turning the LP over, we can, you know, I think we just want to talk a little bit about the LP, but the album cover, because I always thought this was a great, great artwork. A lot of times we don't think about these kind as artwork, because it's like a portrait photograph. But I think, you know, and this is way above my pay grade, but in terms of like how he's offset a little bit to the right, and then the font, the typography, and the colors of it, you know, with the shirt, but the main thing, the exclamation point being kind of separated, I always thought that was
just that the fact that there was an exclamation point.
Yeah,
you know, and it's also one of the few photographs of him not wearing glasses. Most of the time you see him, he's wearing glasses,
right?
And so to see him without glasses kind of gives it even like a more kind of a stronger, you know, look or something. But it's a great photo.
It's like Phineas at night, nighttime edition, you know. But what's interesting, so I'm glad you mentioned about the glasses, because as great as this album cover is, I don't know if you know this, Keys, but it has been, we have some different versions later on of the album that could be considered even better. Same music, different artwork. Like, for instance, look at that.
Oh, yeah.
Remastered 2015. Kind of font, different photograph.
Modern. Yeah, look at
so
that.
Modern, yeah.
Wow. Did my aunt?
A definite improvement.
Did my aunt make that album?
And then there's, of course, there's this here, which makes no sense at all. It makes no sense at all.
That looks like the Crusaders, you know, 1979 or something.
Yeah,
1980. Exactly. Yeah,
going right, just getting into the 80s, barely.
Yeah.
Yeah. So, Weird. But I did find this too. This was cool because I kind of remembered this must be from like one of the original kind of versions, but it's got the monophonic and with the liner notes, which is great.
Set your equalizer to the RIAA curve for optimum right. results.
That's right. That's so awesome. But anyway, so there's that. So now we're flipping over. We're going to the new B rhythm section. Of course, I'm joking, but this is kind of the structurally the big demarcation point in the album, even if you're not listening to it on LP. Mm-hmm. But what's your feelings on this, like in terms of how Phineas is approaching it differently? Is he approaching it differently with the new rhythm with Sam Jones and Lewis Hayes, or is it kind of a continuation?
Yeah, I mean, he just does his thing, but it's just cool to see, you know, to hear him interact with different people. I mean, I love the way that he plays with Roy Haynes too, you know, with Roy and PC, or I mean, you know, or with Alvin, like with Alvin and Ray is a special thing, you know?
Yeah.
Because it's where his time is. Because we always, come back to talking about his time and his groove. And you know, I mean, of course, Alvin, when you talk about Alvin Jones, you know, obviously the first thing that comes to mind is his playing in the John Coltrane Quartet. But, you know, Alvin is on so many records and he played with so many different people. And he's such a versatile and really sensitive accompanist. And you know, hear Alvin play brushes sometimes, and very, you know, very like can adapt to any situation kind of drummer. So there's not just like one Alvin Jones that this is like this massive, overpowering, loose thing that people think of. It's like, you know, it's great to hear him play with Phineas and just hear how they interact. But anyway, this is Sam Jones and Lewis Hayes, which is, you know, it's great. I mean, Lewis Hayes. Listen, I got to play with Lewis quite a bit in the 1990s. We did some. We did a bunch of gigs with Benny Golson, and we did some like Art Blakey, you know, tribute tours and things like that, you know, with Lewis playing drums. And, you know, Lewis has got that old school, that big, fat, wide, loose, you know, ride cymbal beat. And, and it's like a thing that you can't really even talk about, you know, it's just a thing that you have to listen to and experience, you know, but so it's a different kind of pocket, but it's you know, equally killing. You know?
Well, we are going to compare and judge right now. So this is exciting.
Yeah. Let's check it out. This is Oleo. Thank you. I love on the head how he, on the melody, how he lets the left hand drop for just a second every time on that line, on the da-da-da-da-da-da-da. And he brings it back in the place you kind of don't expect it to happen, but it seems like he did it almost every time the same way. It's interesting.
Yeah, I wonder if that's, I mean, it's hard to speculate, but I wonder if that's just like a rare instance of him really just not having that worked out in the left hand or something. It's hard, you know, it sounds like sacrilege to even think such a thing.
Well, but you know, you hear him do this when he's improvising too, though, where,
right.
You know, like he'll be doing the double octaves or even, you know, a wider spread sometimes. And the left hand or the right hand might just drop out for just a few notes or whatever. And I think it's kind of part of the sound. It works.
The listening audience out there, if you don't know it already, you should look up him playing something called the Blues for the Left Hand Only, which is the tune Veered Blues. You know?
Yep.
But, I mean, that was, you know, again, it sounds like two hands playing it. He's got so much going on with just the left hand. It's really great.
Incredible. Well, I don't think we lost a step there with the new drum and bass combo. It's really.
No, and is that arrangement? I mean, I know that it kind of became like a thing, but it's almost like the Miles. Was that the Miles arrangement, like from, you know, Black Hawk, Saturday Night? You know, the rhythm.
Yeah. Thing.
It's a relaxing arrangement, maybe?
Was that on Relaxing too? Yeah, maybe so. But it's funny because it's like you come in and you associate, you know, Philly Joe and PC, and it's like they're coming in and even like laying out and then coming in on the bridge, you know, like the way Philly Joe Jones would do that and stuff. That's interesting.
But this was Sam Jones and Lewis Hayes, so they were playing that arrangement.
I know. Maybe. I'm wondering if that was. Or maybe that's just kind of the way that everybody was playing, and we associated like a lot of these things with Miles.
Probably.
And sometimes Miles wasn't the first one to actually do it. It was like Ahmad Jamal 8 years before or something, you know?
Yeah, probably.
So next up, we've got a Horace Silver tune, which is an interesting choice. This is Juicy Lucy. And I don't think I know this one.
Well, you're about to know it.
I'm about to. Let's check it out. Let's check it out. Thank you. Amazing.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It's amazing. That might be the best track so far.
Well, you know, he was playing tunes by his peers, right? So this was from Horace Silver recorded this like in 1959 on that finger popping record. So it was like 2 years earlier. So it's just like me playing a Peter Martin tune or an Adam Maness tune, or you guys playing one of my, you know what I mean? It's just, yeah, just like mm-hmm. playing each other's tunes. It was great.
That's right.
And he does that on this record. I mean, when did Olio come out? Like not that long before this. So he was basically just, you know, he's covering tunes of other musicians of his era and generation, you know?
That's right. That's right. That's something that I always feel like we don't do enough of, you know, that kind of got lost at a certain point.
Well, my next record is going to be all Peter Martin tunes, man.
Well, that's going to get lost in the record bin very quickly. I don't know. That's what I have with that.
Oh my God! Can I tell you this? This has nothing to do with Phineas Newborn, but I was in Geneva. I was in Geneva, Switzerland. This is like in 2000 and around 2000, something like that. So, I go into this record store. You know, I'm browsing and I'm looking through bins of records and stuff. And I go to this CD bin. It was like the $1. Or one Swiss franc, which was even less than a dollar, like 25 cents bin. Yeah. And I'm like looking through bands and I'm going, man, what are these loser bands that nobody's heard of? And then I found one of my records in there. You know, that happens. So yeah.
That hurts.
You never know, man. You never know. Okay. You might end up in the cutout bin, you know?
Well, you know, the equivalent of that now, and now that I'm telling you this, if you haven't done it, you're going to run, go do it. If you want a humbling experience, put, you know, search for yourself on eBay and then see some like $3 CDs from many years ago. And, you know, then look at the comments and stuff and the condition. And then the fact that it hasn't sold, it's a slippery slope now. Yeah,
they don't even make these anymore. And it's still not even. Yeah.
I'm like, it's not a collector's item. It's gone down in value, man. Come on.
Listen, I actually, there was a Facebook page that probably still exists, but it was called The Worst Album Covers of All Time. Oh boy. And my first album, which was called Waiting in the Wings, it was on Sunnyside.
I like that album cover, man. Yeah. I remember that.
Dude, I mean, that was
you
a look
like you were like 14 years old. That was something I do remember. Yeah.
I was in a pinstripe suit and I was like, you know, like that.
I know.
That actually made it onto the worst album covers of all time Facebook page.
It hurts. No. It hurts. Oh, well, I mean, I think too, well, you know, my kids, I'm sure your guys' kids do this bad as yours may not be old enough, but Keezers, I think are that like, you know, they look at pictures of us in like the late 80s and early 90s. Like, look at this. Looks so stupid. I'm like, that was the style.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, now I can hide behind that. I wasn't even in the style, but that was the style. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah, everybody was wearing their shirts that big back then. That's what right. We did.
We all had shoulder pads, man.
It'll come back around. That's why I still have that stuff. I just figured.
That's right.
I don't care about, you know.
That's right.
Eventually. That's right. You know.
Right. I got my fanny packs. Now it's hip. Come on now.
That's right.
So it looks like these last two tunes. So this next tune, this is the seventh out of eighth. This is called For Carl by Leroy Vinegar.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Bassist.
Great bass player. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah.
And it was so, he was so ahead of his time because, I mean, Carl Allen probably wasn't even born for another 2 years. And he wrote this tune for him. It was so cool, man.
Maybe not the same Carl, Peter.
No, it's for Carl Perkins, the pianist Carl Perkins.
Right.
Perkins. Yeah.
Yeah.
And then after that is Kabu by Roland Alexander.
Yeah. I don't know the background on that tune, but again, probably maybe another, you know, contemporary of that time.
It seems like, yeah, it was a contemporary, which is really interesting. So let's check out For Carl, and then, yeah, here it is, For Carl. Thank you.
Thank you.
Pickardy third.
Am I muted? Oh, I'm muted. One thing I was thinking about, like, I mean, he does this all over the place, but, you know, for most humans, you know, it's enough to just play a solo, like come up with a solo line. Like, say, okay, you come up with a good line. It's got a nice flow to it. It's got a, you know, nice phrase, whatever you play. And that's like, that's it. And then you move on to the next phrase. But Phineas will play a line and then comment on it, like comp for himself, literally. Mm-hmm. And you could really hear examples of that in this solo where he'll play a line. You know, it's like, you know, not just coming up with like, you know, great ideas, but commenting and having a dialogue with his own ideas, you know?
Yeah. No, it's fantastic. And and big shout out to both rhythm sections for getting out of the way at the right times, but allowing that to happen while still contributing so much, you know, like that's a real dance you have to do, and not just to kind of go into automatic pilot, be like, oh, the piano player is playing a lot, so I'm just going to, you know, they're conversing as well, but they're adjusting to the way his own conversation with himself and just the sheer number of notes and ideas and thoughts and flow that he's in. I think that makes the album as much as what Phineas is playing.
I'm really digging, really paying attention to Lewis Hayes on this too, because there was something he did on Juicy Lucy where Phineas went into this Errol Garner thing, like a march, kind of blues march almost kind of thing.
The four on the floor thing.
Yeah, with his left hand. And Lewis Hayes, he went to doing only snare drum and cymbal.
Yeah.
He just went ting, 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 ting. That he didn't do spang-a-lang. He just did quarter notes for like two A sections, but that was like absolutely the perfect thing to do, because what it did was it brought out what Phineas was doing. It highlighted what he was doing in that moment, you know.
And that takes a lot record, of,
you know,
absolutely. And that takes a lot of discipline to be like, and not to try to. There's so many different things you can add to that, but
well, I was going to say too. I think Lewis Hayes, Geoffrey, you mentioned his wide beat, right? I think his beat really complements Phineas's sense of time. Like it's a whole other thing. It really, they have a nice.
It almost sounds like Phineas has more room to shred on side B of this record.
I agree.
Something about
it feels comfortable somehow. The
space.
And to your point about the answering himself, I mean, again, he's a master orchestrator here in the moment, you know, and he's using, I'm hearing all these lines that he's doing, the tenor region. I mean, they sound like horn lines or cello lines, like French horn lines or cello lines that you would write in an orchestra. I mean, he's using them in the same way you would use those tenor instruments to, you know, I mean, much in the same way that like Antonio Carlos Jobim would use that same range in that same way to kind of.
Who?
Tom Jobim, you know him?
Oh, Tom. Tom, of course.
Jim Beam's brother, Joe Beam.
Jim Beam's brother, Joe Beam.
Jim's Brazilian brother from south of the border.
but using it to not just respond, but outline the harmony in that way that you would use that tenor register. It's awesome. It's awesome to hear. And like you said, it doesn't sound planned out or contrived at all. It sounds just in the moment and natural.
And so, and Josh makes an astute point here. This is an album of independence etudes. I think, I wonder what you guys think about, you know, Phineas's, obviously, you know, a very high level of independence of the hands, independence of the fingers, but even beyond that, being able to orchestrate in this way where he's like combining the independence of the hands with independence of the registers, you know, and the different zones and being able to play those. I think it's just like a textbook example of many different ways to do that on here. And you could almost go through and listen to this album again, just concentrating on that facet of his playing and really get some great ideas. I
mean, is there another pianist that uses the whole piano? Maybe Tatum, you know, more than maybe in certain ways a Majumal, but I don't know. I mean, he really uses every register.
Yeah, kind of equally, and it's you know, the concept or conception. It's just like this, you know, fully conceived thing, you know, arrangement. But it's spontaneous too. It's just in the moment, and you know, I don't know. It's really genius. It really is.
Like,
truly, you know, a word that's overused. Anybody that can play a little bit is now a genius, you know.
But that's right. Man, you can play Olio in D flat. You're a genius. You're a genius.
You know,
you slapped your way through that. Come on, man.
Yeah.
Nikola Tesla, Albert Einstein, you know, Phineas Newborn.
That's right.
Charlie Parker. Like, there's very few, you know.
Yeah, totally. No, I think the thing with Phineas maybe is the reason some may, I mean, certainly not after you listen to this record, I don't think anybody with ears is, would dispute him being a genius. He didn't have, as you alluded to earlier in the evening, he didn't have the output and the longevity and, you know, the many, many 20, 30 records and the many years, you know, and that some of these other musicians and artists did. But that doesn't mean that, I mean, you know, the proof, if you do one album like this, you know, look, 99% of pianists never get to this level on even one album. So it doesn't matter if you hit 95, if you hit a solid A minus on 30 records, it doesn't matter if you can hit an A plus on one record, it's like, peace and I'm out, you know, you're good.
but he made a bunch of good records, though, especially around this period. You know, there's Newborn Touch is fantastic. There's one called The Great Jazz Piano, Phineas Newborn, you know.
That We Three record you mentioned.
That was actually the second one. This one led me to that, I remember. So I had a couple questions for you before we listen to the first track and float off into the evening, Geoffrey. But this is actually from Zach. So he did say, I had to look up the waiting in the, since you brought it up, the cover is that, and I was like, what are you talking about? Peacock feather.
There is.
So we've got to figure this out here. Okay.
Oh, so, the worst album.
What is he talking about? What is he talking about? Peacock. Oh, I guess it's the overlay there. Yeah.
Look at that kid from Wisconsin, man.
But what is the peacock? Was that something that you asked to have involved? It's like a feather boa?
I mean,
like
waiting in the wings, kind of the word wings, and they found a wing, I guess, a peacock feather. You know?
How old were you?
Nice. Okay.
How old were you?
17, man.
I mean, come on.
He was waiting in the wings to even become a legal, you know, participant in the CD and LP trade. That's what
when I was in Art Blakey's band, I was 18. I could not legally be in the bars that we were playing in.
That's right.
You know, like when we would some rooms we would play, I could be on stage and I could be in the dressing room, but I couldn't really be in the space between the stage and the dressing room, you know?
Right.
Yeah.
Which is amazing because here you're 17 and you actually look like you might be the accountant or the manager for Art Blakey at the time. So it's kind of
I was the shady accountant for Art Blakey. Yeah. Yeah.
The shady accountant.
Yeah,
that's great stuff.
Much better album cover here, World of Piano.
I love it, man. Looks great.
But you know what? Let's just throw this up there. This wasn't your problem. This was a problem during that era. You know what I'm saying?
We got to go through all of Peter's 80s and 90s album covers.
Exactly,
You know, nobody got out unscathed. Nobody got out unscathed.
Even Phineas Newborn in the 80s. Look, you know what I'm saying? That's what I'm saying. This was like this was a problem during the era. This was not personal. Man. This is, you know, shame on somebody. Come on. So, man, Geoffrey, thank you so much for just breaking this album down like this. I couldn't think of somebody just more astute and interesting and with the insights into this record. And I've been listening to this record. I hadn't listened to it in a while. I've been looking forward to tonight to kind of experiencing with you and with everybody. But it really is. I mean, look, these records, it's a rare thing that it can get better over the years. And like, how old were you when you first, do you remember when you first heard this record?
Yeah, about 16, 17, you know, again, with James Williams that hit me to it. And,
right.
And, out of curiosity, Geoffrey, because I know we have a lot of piano students on here watching and listening tonight. So did you learn these arrangements and these tunes from this album? I mean, I know
some of it, I can't honestly say that I know this album note by note. I don't know every note on it, but I learned a lot of it and I transcribed quite a bit of it, but even more than that, I just learned from the concepts on the record and the ideas, you know, the idea of orchestrating, the idea of commenting on your own phrases, you know, and using the full 88 keys of the piano and, you know, even assigning sort of different, you know, the left hand could play something. I'm off camera. Left hand could play something down here and then play something, you know, in answer to it while the right hand is doing something independent of that. You know, just like the ideas, you know, the sort of, you know, not exactly the notes, but the concepts, you know.
Yeah,
totally. I mean, yeah. And it comes through. It really does come through. It's so cool to hear, you know, musicians that I love, i.e. you, to hear you listen to your influences is really, really fun. So got a little surprise here for everybody. Hold on just a second, folks, because we're gonna bring something up here and just
oh good,
even though Peter knows what's about to happen here,
but I can only imagine that it's many many places it can go.
Hold on everybody.
Come on, Adam.
Sorry, man. Blame. Don't blame the messenger.
No, we want to thank everybody for being here. We had sure. A great crowd of oh, come
the
on,
the 90s. Now, you know what I'm saying? Gold jacket. One hand in the pocket. One hand though.
Oh God, I look both shady and ugly at the same time. And
ugly. No, you're cool, but that's like an oak tree. Sport coat.
It's like
you remember the oak tree?
Dude, I think that was from you. No, I think I purchased that at the oak tree. So that's you would be spot on with that.
Oh yeah.
It's such a fancy word too, parabola, for such a casual dude.
And you know what's bad about this? This is actually fairly good. I messed up some fairly good design, like the lettering. I mean, it's not great, but you know what I mean. Like I kind of screwed this one up with my. With my uber anti-suave vibe going on there. And I like that you got it the lowest possible res JPEG. That actually makes it better.
I did it in 15 seconds, man. So I did my best.
No, that was good. No, it's a much better thing. But
this is why I only have just conceptual art for all of my album covers. There's no reason to put, you know, just drawings of myself on the inside cover. That's all I need.
Quick side note. Do you guys remember at the oak tree, how you'd get the jacket, a shirt,
yes,
I the think belt. Pants, maybe like socks and a belt, yep, for $99. It didn't matter what, everything was $99 for like the whole outfit, if you could call it that.
Well, it was a shirt, jacket, and socks and a belt and no pants, and that's the problem, that I would wear these outfits and I would never have any pants. Right. I'd show up to gigs, you know. And...
Oh, come on.
Elias has a great idea. Maybe do a viewing sesh devoted entirely to terrible album covers.
Well, we've got two already, so. Oh, man. Yeah, so there you go. Nice. Well, Geoffrey, thank you so much for being here and really for the idea. We got to rib you a little bit, though. We didn't get a chance to do that, Adam. So you were scheduled to do this like 11 weeks ago. Yeah. And then you were like, oh, I can't do it. And we're like, oh, it's no problem. We're here every week. It's a pandemic. And then it was like the next week, like, I can't do it. And then you were like, I can't do it until April 6th. This is like late January. And we're like, man, Geoff Keezer is so killing. Even in the middle of a pandemic, like when the curve got really bad, he still had gigs to do or something to do. So,
no.
But you made it worthwhile. You made the wait worthwhile for sure.
Yeah, thank you. Well, thanks for having me on. And thanks for you know, patiently waiting. It's just great, like you were saying, it's just great to listen to, because I listened to this record so many times as a teenager and in my 20s, and it's just so great to go back to it and just still be like floored by this album.
It's stunning.
And everything
it's,
he plays on it.
It's truly stunning. Josh has a question. Did you ever talk to the great Ray Brown about Phineas Newborn?
Because but like it was just kind of Ray saying, like, you know, this MF could play anything, you know, he would just say stuff like that about him. But
awesome.
So we want to, just as a little you know, light at the end of the tunnel, what would be fun, we want to invite you, Geoffrey, next time you're in town playing, which I hope will be relatively soon, and hopefully sooner than we even think. But we are in the process, we're just tease this out to our sesh folks, of, you know, building a new open studio right around the corner from where we currently are. And one of the things that we're hoping to be able to do is some sessions in person, and even dropping the needle, maybe having, like, going old school with the LP, a little area. It's possible we might have a bourbon tasting going on at the same time for selected guests as yourself. So you can put that, you know, record, or maybe something else.
Delta Airlines.
Yeah. Now your St. Louis. Open. You were busy for 4 months. Now your schedule opened up. See?
Suddenly.
But no, we really look forward to that. And hopefully even have some of our loyal viewers here that happen to be in town or coming to town. So that's kind of the dream. And Adam and I have been working on that and the rest of the Open Studio crew. So that's something to look forward to. I don't know, maybe 6 months from now, maybe 3 months, maybe Great. 9 months, but that's, yeah. that's where we're going with this.
Beautiful. Yeah.
Was cool. I supposed well, to mention that, Adam?
No, man, construction's underway. It's happening.
It we're is. Doing it. It is. Yeah. That's right.
So we're going to go out. This is a tune by a saxophonist named Roland Alexander from Boston. And I'm just kind of Googling him. He did some stuff, but I don't really know much of what he's done. But he wrote this tune called Kabu. And this is the final track on Phineas Newborn Jr.'s incredible album, A World of Piano, from 1962. Released in 1962, recorded in 1961. Thanks, everybody. Have a great night. Cheers.
Thanks, everyone. Peace.
Later.